Talk to Yuri Sack, who's an advisor to Ukraine's Minister of Defence and is on the line. Good afternoon to you, Mr. Sack. Interesting, up to now, Ukraine has been very tight-lipped about the drone attacks in Moscow, not explicitly claiming responsibility, but seem to be claiming this. Is there a difference there? Why is that?
Good afternoon, Simon.
Good afternoon.
Now, since this large-scale invasion began, of course, we have been reliant very much on the support, on the military support of our allies. But at the same time, we have been putting in a lot of effort into developing, despite the war, despite the incessant missile strikes, we have been putting our efforts into developing our own capabilities. So drone industry is one of the areas in which we have, in many respects, excelled. So the sort of events that we see unfold now, they, you know, we are under Article 51 of the UN Charter entitled to the right to self-defense because we are a victim of an aggression. We're a victim of a genocidal war. So, you know, we have said it in the past that we will honor our commitment before our international partners not to use the weapons that they provide us with to attack Russia outside of Russia. But at the same time, under international law and by all laws of God and nature, we are entitled to protect our people, cities, and we will do that.
So what you're saying is you've been busy developing a homegrown drone technology which you feel able to deploy outside the borders because they weren't supplied to you by allies. And so we should expect more of this kind of attack.
Well, we have said it very openly that, you know, as long as this war lasts, we will use everything that is available to us of our own production to inflict the damage and losses on the enemy until they withdraw completely from our territory.
Okay. This tit for tat, obviously Russia has been attacking the Ukraine's ability to export grain. This looks like Ukraine going after Russian oil exports, obviously a key financial weapon of war for them.
Simon, I would, with all due respect, I would not call this a tit for tat because it kind of trivializes the situation. Now, we are fighting off an aggressor and, for example, the seaports that you have mentioned, they are used to refuel the Russian army, which is on a daily basis pulverizing and destroying our cities and killing our people. So, you know, Russia is a terrorist state which is using missile strikes on Odessa to starve the world, to create a global food crisis. We are fighting a defensive war and we just want to repel our enemy, and we are doing everything to degrade the capabilities, the offensive capabilities, first of all, of our enemy. And if there are oil depots in those ports, we will be targeting them, of course.
Serbian. Okay. What is odd of this, is despite all of this and what you've just been saying, seems to be inconsistent with talk of peace on both sides. I just wonder whether that's an acknowledgement that we've reached some sort of stalemate, particularly on the Eastern Front, because what you're saying just there doesn't seem very compatible with noises on both sides about looking for peaceful solutions come the autumn.
We've never made noises about the peace plan. We've been very clear and very vocal and transparent about our only alternative, which is a peace plan proposed by President Zelensky, consisting of 10 very specific, very clearly defined points. So, and our position has not changed since that plan was announced. And we're just doing a lot of diplomatic work to convince our partners, you know, in the West and elsewhere to get behind this peace plan that is proposed by President Zelensky. And, you know, hopefully this will gain momentum. And because the peace plan can only be possible on the terms which are outlined in that proposal. You know, Russian withdrawal from Ukraine is number one.
Okay. Yuri Sack, advisor to Ukraine's Minister of Defence. Thanks very much for joining the World at One today. Thank you.